Dog training is a little like a paint-by-number kit. To paint a crisp, clear picture, we really need a full palette of colors to paint with. The training offered to companion dog owners often offers just one or two colors. Some trainers embrace a might-is-right approach and recommend responding to undesirable behavior in a dog with a physical correction of some sort. Other trainers believe that all positive, all the time training is the only color that dog owners need and suggest that ignoring bad behavior and rewarding good behavior will always result in a dog choosing to do what their owners wish. Now personally, if my mother and father had embraced a might is right only approach for teaching me to be civilized, I'd very likely have had to spend a good part of my adult life in therapy. But on the other hand, if they'd ignored my bad behavior and only rewarded my good behavior, I'd likely now be dead in jail or under house arrest somewhere. The impact these single color methods have on dogs in the dog training world is not dissimilar. Balance training embraces what I refer to in my book, The Beautiful Balance, as working with nature's template. In nature, no dog, wolf, ape, or human being, or any other higher social species for that matter, has ever incorporated all positive all the time into their parenting strategies, nor have any solely used might is right to teach their little ones. They, of course, use a lot of positive and once in a while, a bit of consequence. I'll be showing you how to signal your dog as to whether he or she is warm or cold with your tone and your body language, much the same as a mother dog might with pups or an adult dog with another adult dog, as opposed to doing that with treats or physical corrections. In fact, treats are very rarely used, if ever used. And corrections, as I say, are tone and body language based, as opposed to having anything to do with pain or fear. However, as important as the colors, tone, and body language are in balance training, there are other important colors that impact the success of training as well. Some play a larger role than others, but we'll take them all into consideration in your program. Nutrition, for instance, the quality of food, the treats that people use, the amount fed, free feeding versus scheduled feeding are just a few nutrition factors that can affect dogs mentally and physically and potentially your training. And so in balance training, we take that into account. Exercise is another color, and one that has a huge impact on how well your dog can focus and perform during and outside of training. If you have a dog designed for hardcore cardiovascular daily stimulation that's only getting a walk around the block once or even twice a day, you can take your training time very seriously and still have your success negatively impacted overall. So as part of our training program, we show you how to get your dog exercised without having to turn you into a marathon runner. Another incredibly important color and often overlooked in dog training is the need for mental stimulation. Many breeds are work-oriented and yet find themselves in households where they essentially get laid off the same day they get hired. An IQ of 140 can put a child in jail just as easily as university, and a smart dog's intelligence can also undermine its freedom in the long term if we don't offer more than the challenge of an obedience class. So balance training also helps dog owners by showing them how to keep their dogs' minds productively busy with strategies for when they do interact together, but also when the owner is busy with other obligations, which we understand for a lot of people is a good part of their day. But in balance training, what is probably the most powerful color that impacts success is the impact of a dog's perception of its relationship with you, its owner. So it's a topic I incorporate thoroughly into my program. If we stood back and took an honest assessment of how we live and interact with our dogs day in, day out, relationship-wise, you could make the argument that many people live with their dogs in ways that the dog might very well end up seeing us more as college roommates rather than someone they need to pay attention to when the pizza guy is at the door. Now that doesn't mean that's a bad relationship. It's just it's not very conducive for giving a dog a reason to take direction when you want to teach him or her things that will provide a lot more freedom down the road. Dogs are learning 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, whether we're teaching or not. And the time we spend together in class, even combined with whatever time you have to practice at home, I know is still significantly going to be impacted by your dog's observations the rest of the time. So as part of your training, I'm going to show you how in little but powerfully effective ways you can productively align yourself with the way your dog sees the world. You'll learn how dogs make connections as to who should be the teacher and who should be the student, and it will have a wonderful positive impact on your overall training success. Hopefully this gives you a sense of what I mean by balanced training and what to expect whether you choose a group class or an in-home visit. Either way, if you have questions, give me a call or send me an email. You should also know that I regularly send out dog training and behavior articles, videos, and sometimes even podcasts. And about once a month, I organize a free lecture on topics for London dog owners. If you want to be made aware of these as they become available, sign up for my no more than once weekly newsletter. It's always brief. And of course, there are the Twitter, Facebook, and RSS options for staying in touch as well.